startup. How many have already worked with WebGL before? No. Okay, good. So the talk is an introduction to WebGL, which is basically an API in the browser to draw graphics via the GPU. And we'll do a very introductory thing. So if you already have a lot of experience with WebGL, I don't think it's going to help you. But if you've not used the native API and you're used to using, you know, libraries like 3JS or higher level libraries, and you want to get an introduction to the basic WebGL API, and then also this talk will be helpful. Can somebody tell me what the GPU is? Graphics processing unit. How is it different from your CPU? What's the difference? Sorry?
CPU or processing numbers and stuff, I think this is
called images. Okay. Just one more. Dedicated CPU, it's for images. One more? Okay, so to the point of numbers, okay, everything in computer science is numbers, eventually. So the GPU also does number processing at the end of it all. As far as your definition is, it separates out image processing. It is dedicated for graphics. That's the original intent, but not necessarily. So, that's interesting. So, can you repeat that?
Digital instructions is an operator
matrices. So, the key difference is that a GPU is made up of several small processors. So they are not as advanced and as fast as the CPU. So CPU, the one processor in the CPU is faster than individual processors in the GPU. But because GPU has several of them, it can do things in parallel, and that's why it ends up being faster. And especially for images, it ends up being faster because, well, images are a set of pixels. Yeah, so I don't have any slides today. I'm just going to walk through a little bit of code. Alright, can you read? Alright, this is the Wikipedia definition for GPU, okay? A graphics processing unit or a GPU is a specialized circuit designed to rapidly manipulate and alter memory in such a way that it can accelerate the building of images in a frame buffer intended to output. Intended for output to a display. Okay, so essentially it's a means to quickly manipulate memory, right? So if you have a bunch of values in memory, a GPU is a unit that can take that array of values and transform all of them parallelly. So instead of doing it sequentially, let's say you wanted to multiply each number in an array by 2, if you did it in a CPU, it will go from first location, second location, third location, it will do it sequentially, right? But if you give it to a GPU, it will just multiply all of them together because it has several processors. And just to make that a little more clear, alright, never mind. So, the video I was trying to show you was this video by this group called Mythbusters. It's a TV show if you've ever seen. So they try to show you in nice interactive ways, explain scientific concepts. So they have a video where they show the CPU drawing first, and they have this injector which goes one by one. So if it's drawing a smiley face, it'll draw 1 pixel, second pixel, third pixel, fourth pixel, fifth pixel. They do it like this. This is how CPU would draw a circle, right? But if it was the GPU, they show the same example where it's not drawing a smiley face, but it has several thousand injectors, and all of them parallelly paint the Mona Lisa on a wall, right? So it's just that a GPU is essentially a collection of several small, simple processors. Alright. So, and what is WebGL? Right, so WebGL, have people used Canvas here? Canvas, okay. So, Canvas is the drawing surface that we have inside new browsers, so like HTML5 today. And WebGL is a context, one of the contexts you can get from Canvas. So you can get the regular 2D context from Canvas, or you can get the WebGL context. It is based on this specification called OpenGL ES, which is used in a lot of mobile phones and a lot of desktops as well. So the API looks almost the same, even though this is a C-based API. But the JavaScript version looks almost exactly the same. In fact, there is no documentation for the JavaScript version as well. You have to read the C documentation to figure stuff out. And it is not necessarily for 3D. So the major misconception a lot of people end up having with CPU processing is that you need it only when you need to do 3D graphics manipulation, a lot of graphics manipulation, for example, right? But GPU is not necessarily for that. It can just as easily handle two dimensions, and it can just as easily handle non-graphics, because essentially it's a number processor. It's a number processor that takes an array of values and manipulates that array of values into something else, right? So you don't have to necessarily use it for graphics. In fact, I run a small company which is into data analysis, and the main use we are doing of GPU is on the server to do data analysis of large data sets, right? And we're also using it on the client to do data visualization, but that's not a main use. So GPUs can be really, really fast for other purposes as well. So that's what I was trying to say here, that it's really a low-level drawing API. Okay? So it doesn't care whether you're drawing 2D or 3D. That's up to you, how you figure out how you want to draw 2D or 3D. It has a three-dimensional coordinate system, but that's about it, right? So this is where I wanted to show demos, but I don't think I have internet access. All right, so we'll get to the demos later, okay? We'll start by writing our first GPU program. So, can everybody read? Or does this need to be bigger? Bigger? Yeah. Good. So, we're going to be doing from this point on programming, and it's going to follow a flow, okay? So, because it's new, so the programming language is different from JavaScript. You can access it from JavaScript, but the core concepts are different, and how the runtime functions is also different. So, try and pay attention, and if you get lost, stop me, and we take a quick look back again, then come back, okay? And this is the only way I could think of how to explain this. Alright, just to start with, I have a simple skeleton page. This is going to be the basis of any WebGL application if you write. What am I doing here? I've created a canvas. So you need to run WebGL, you need canvas. In fact, you can't even run it in all browsers today. You can run it in pretty much everything else except IE. Because Microsoft isn't behind the standard, and it's not yet a standard, so it's a proposed thing, although the specification is complete, it's 1.0, and it's finalized. Most browsers are fixated on what it should be, but as of IE10, Microsoft isn't supporting it. And their arguments haven't been very well founded, but it's just them, they're not supporting it, and they're not supporting it, 50% of users are not getting it, right? But the good thing is, almost all recent mobiles have it, which is great, at least the smartphones have it, which is great because if you're doing a mobile-specific thing, you can use it. If you're not doing a mobile-specific thing, if you're doing a web-based application, then as long as you have Canvas, you can do things. So you can fall back from WebGL to Canvas. In fact, a lot of the common libraries, WebGL libraries that are available, like VJS, do that. They try to draw it in WebGL, but if they don't get the WebGL context, they draw it in Canvas itself. The problem with that is that Canvas isn't GPU accelerated, at least in most browsers, except for IE. So your rendering will be slightly slower, but still kind of works. So this is a basic shell. We have a Canvas in place, and this is my initialization startup function. Once I have the Canvas initializing, before I go too fast, everybody here knows JavaScript, right? Alright, cool. Yes. Alright, perfect. So, we'll actually see the demos first. That will be motivation, hopefully, to stay awake. Because we're going to see a lot of code. So we'll see the demo again. Many of them are done using PJS, but you know that's just one of the popular libraries. I'm going to open my favorite one. This is really high-end 3D that's possible in the browser today, right? It's a really high-quality texture. In fact, if you weren't limited by network bandwidth, you could have gone higher quality even. And as far as the 3D model is concerned, it isn't that complex, although the face part is fairly complex. If you're into that kind of thing, you want to build games with realistic, figures and stuff like that, that's interesting. This one's the cars demo, so you can obviously, if you have 3D, not building cars, car racing, of course, isn't going to help, right? And you can change the camera and stuff like that. This one's pretty cool. This one's my favorite. The resolution never
is
very popular. Sorry? Okay, I'll tell you. So this shows an application that wasn't possible on the web before this. Right. So what this company does is they collect data about human body movement, right? And they've measured how humans move in certain scenarios, right? When they are sick or when they have different moves, right? What this application does is it visualizes that data. For example, if you're really really sad, then you're moving like that, right? And you're super happy, then you're moving like that. If you're if you're male, you have a super macho look. If you're super female, you have a female look. And what's unique about this is that, as far as the application is concerned, it isn't. If once you learn WebGL, it isn't very complex to build, but it opens up new avenues. See, why this wasn't possible in old browsers? Because they have to process. This model is built out of small little triangles. Every curve is built out of several little triangles. And so this is probably a few hundred thousand points. And every time it's already moving all those few hundred thousand points, but every time I change this, all those have to be manipulated. So this is really, really fast data processing that just wasn't possible in the browser before, right? And with WebGL starts to become interesting. You can obviously rotate this angle. And I'll open one more and then we'll move on to this one's a visualization of earthquakes around the world in the last 5-6 years and does it really nicely. We'll open this one. Has anybody seen this? Google had this body explorer last year, I think. Can you see it? Cool. So this is another application that just wasn't possible on the web earlier. Theoretically, if you say web, it still isn't possible because WebGL isn't part of the web standard, but anyways. Alright, so this is that earthquake visualization. I can't see all the controls. Okay, so. It's a nice little model. It's very simple to build, actually, theoretically. So when I clicked on something, right, it showed me one earthquake with its how far did it stretch? And I think it's pretty nice. So my reason for showing this was that most people have this conception that, you know, you look at the GPU when you're building games, right? The reality is GPU processing is everywhere, you know, and on your iPhone, the moment you do a swipe, that swipe is so smooth because it's using the GPU, right? It wasn't possible in other browsers, other phones earlier because they didn't have good quality GPUs, and the iPhone came out with a pretty decent quality GPU. And the reason you see all those nice effects is because they're being done in the GPU. So if you want that stuff in your client, your UI as well, it must be done in the GPU. Although in at least the latest browser with CSS3 and CSS3 transitions, you do get some amount of GPU acceleration, but WebGL gives you more control. So we'll keep that example as it loads for a little while for a break, and we'll come back to our code, okay? So this is my skeleton. I've created a canvas, and I've called a self-executing function that figures out what gets that canvas element by ID and passes it to the function. Everybody here understands what's happening here, right? Okay, if you don't understand this, then we have a problem. So just ask right now. Alright, so we have a function, and the reason I've created this is because this is where my scope is going to be. I'm not going to modify anything outside. My scope is this function. Everything I do will be inside this function. And now I move on to a simple example. So, alright, so the first thing you need to do, just like with anything you do on the canvas, is to get a context. Right? And if you're doing regular canvas drawing, you get a 2D context. You might be familiar with this API call, which is canvas.getContext. In regular canvas drawing, you say 2D, but in WebGL, you say experimental WebGL. And this experimental is going to go away very soon. The standard is final, so most probably this will become WebGL soon. You must do this in a tri-catch block because on browsers that don't have this, they will throw an exception. They don't just fail, they throw an exception. So you might want to catch and react to that exception, but as long as my context is null after I've done this, I assume that WebGL is not valid. Right, so this could be a quick WebGL test if you want to run it and see if your browser supports WebGL. And I finally log the fact that I've gotten a WebGL context, and I log the context object as well. So I will just quickly run this before this application is ready. But we'll open it in a little while. So if you go look at our console, you see that my message got printed, and this context object got returned. In this context object is basically your window to the GPU. You can only access the GPU by doing something on this context object, right? And what happens is the moment I create a WebGL context, something called a drawing buffer gets created. Right? This drawing buffer basically has information about all the pixels that you want to draw. Right? So because my canvas was 500 pixel by 500 pixel, my drawing buffer is 500 by 500. But the actual memory it is taking is more. It is not taking just 500 into 500 bytes or whatever. It's taking more memory. Why? Because at each pixel, I need to store color information, which is R, G, B, red, green, blue, and the alpha at that pixel. And it also stores two other values. One is called depth, which basically means that if you're drawing two objects, which one is ahead, is in front and which one is in the back. And there's a third value called stencil that you don't need to bother with right now. But basically, each pixel has these RGBA, depth, and stencil. So the overall size of this buffer that gets created is 500 into 500 into the size that all those values take to store, right? And this drawing buffer is where you will do all your manipulation. And the GPU will then eventually render information from this drawing buffer. So it's important that we've created the drawing buffer. Okay. So you know, this was a simple enough starting point. So now you may notice that even though I've gotten a context and I told you that that's the one being used for drawing, you don't see anything on the page, right? But it has actually drawn. The reason you don't see it is because the default value of alpha is 0, right? So the default value at each pixel is 0, 0, 0, 0, which is red, RGB are 0 and alpha is also 0, which basically means that that object is invisible, right? And that's why you don't see it. But you can change that if you want to. If we were to go back to our example and quickly, in the options here, pass for false. We see a black area. Okay, so this is my 500 by 500 pixel canvas. But typically you don't want this, right? Typically you want to deal with you may or may not, depending on your application, you may or may not want this. So what we've done is created a context. The context got drawn immediately. Now this immediate is important. So WebGL is an immediate mode graphics area. And it's different from retained mode graphics API. So, for example, in the browser, we used to the DOM, right? So, we create a div, and that div appears, right? But this div doesn't appear immediately. The first thing when you say DOM.add, you add a div to the add element div, what happens is that the DOM, which is a data model representing what is on the screen, gets updated. And then later on, asynchronously, a rendering phase gets triggered in the browser, and then this DOM, which is the data model of the screen, gets reflected actually on the screen. This is called retained mode drawing, and it's common in pretty much all UI frameworks in the browsers. If you're using Flash, it's called display list. If you're using some other UI frameworks, they're called screen graphs, things like that. But basically, retained mode APIs have a data model representing what's on the screen, right? But immediate mode drawing APIs simply just draw. So the moment you tell it to do something, it will go do it. So if you tell it to draw a line, it will go draw the line, and after that, it will not remember that it drew a line, right? So no, there is no data model that tells you that there was a line drawn. Right? And that's the difference between immediate mode and retained mode APIs. You could, of course, build a library on top of WebGL which would do the retaining for you. So you could create your own data model and say, I have four cubes in my system. This is the length and breadth and height of each cube. And then later on render all of those cubes by calling WebGL APIs. But WebGL itself is immediate, which means that the moment I created this context, the canvas actually got rendered, right? The reason we didn't see it was because its alpha was 0, right? Now we'll change that, we'll actually set a background, right? So we'll set a background to that context, and this is how you do it. So remember I said that the drawing buffer has values about each pixel. It has the RGB and alpha values of each pixel, right? The default value of RGB and alpha is 0000, right? But we can change that. And we change that by calling this clear color method. Clear color method basically says that when clear is called, use these values as the default. Right, and the next thing you have to do is clear the buffer. So when we say clear the drawing buffer, it basically goes to each pixel value and changes the color to whatever we set here, right? And in the argument, I'm basically passing a flag that says only deal with the color values, don't modify the depth and the stencil values. These are also other values, right, in the buffer. So This is what I did. Now let's see what happens. So now I have a red square, right? And I can do all sorts of fancy things. I got, you know. Another man got random attack. Alright, so I'll get now random attack. Okay, so what you notice is that the refresh actually takes a lot of time. So this is an important comment. Okay? Alright, so we're going to hurry up. Alright, but meanwhile, let's see this example that I opened up for you. Alright, so this one is a it has a data model of basically the entire body, all our muscles, all our brain muscles and whatever, right? You can do all that exploring here. I will pass on the links and you can see them later. It's actually pretty cool. You can just like Google Earth zoom into your brain or this zygote's brain rather than your brain. But that's pretty cool. We move on to the next example. So far we've done very little, okay? We've drawn a background, right? And in the next 5 minutes, I'm going to try and draw a square. And that's about it. But in the process of drawing the square, I'll hopefully explain all the concepts required to do GPU drawing. So here's how GPU drawing is done. Okay, the GPU is a separate processor from the CPU. So you do not have access to the same things that you have access in the GPU. Whenever you want to run something in the GPU, you have to upload it to the GPU and then tell it to run, right? And this thing that you upload to the GPU can be of two kinds. It can be instructions or programs, and it can be data. Right? So the data is generally stored in buffers, or you can think of them as arrays, and you can create an array and push that array to the GPU. Then you can create a GPU program and push the program to the GPU, and then tell the program to operate on the data. Right? But this is happening in a separate processor, you have to understand that. So when the result has to be gotten back, you may have to get it back from the hardware. Right? These programs that you push to the GPU are called shaders, right? So buffers are what you store the data in, and shaders are what are used to operate on that data. I don't believe you. 10 minutes? For Q&A? Oh, that's what I was saying. Okay, so do you have Q&As already? Or do you want to let me finish? I'm sorry. Yeah. So, So, all right. So shader is a set of instructions you send to the GPU to run on the data. Right? It will process the data, transform the data. So the goal of the GPU is to take data, modify that data in some form, and push it to the frame buffer, which actually renders it on the screen. That's the goal, right? So we push the data and we push the instructions. It runs the instructions and gets the output and displays it on the screen, right? But these instructions are called shaders, and they're written in a different language. This is called GLSL, graphics shader language, something. And this is a different language. That is why I'm not going to try and teach you, but I'm going to show you a simple example, right? And with
You said that, you know, it doesn't matter if it's 3D or 2D. All the examples you show basically 3D implementation, right?
Yes, but I'm going to just draw a rectangle, which is a two-dimensional rectangle. That's the goal of our exercise.
My question is, how does the benefit of its performance?
How does it benefit performance of 2D drawing? Now I don't have an example of it at all, but essentially this is, at the end of it all, everything is 2D drawing, right? Our frame buffer, the frame buffer of your hardware is two-dimensional, right? So at the end of it all, everything you draw on the screen is two-dimensional. And that is how it is, but the speed advantage is that you can process each pixel faster. So for example, if you're building Instagram and you wanted to make $2 billion, what you would essentially do is you would take an image and process each pixel with a bunch of trigonometric operations to transform that pixel. Now this trigonometric operation, each operation that happens on the image is very costly. So if you do it sequentially on each pixel, it will take you forever. But if you do it in parallel, which is what the GPU does, you can do it much quicker. And that is why in 2D image processing also you can use the GPU. Alright, coming back to our example, so shaders look like this. Okay, there are two kinds of shaders. So this program, the set of instructions that we send to the GPU to run, right? It is made up of two types of shaders. One is called vertex shader, the other one is called fragment shader. The vertex shader basically decides the position to draw each point. Okay? And the fragment shader decides the color of that point. Okay? So the vertex shader basically figures out where to draw each point, and the fragment shader figures out what is the color of each pixel, right? And these are two really simple, this is a vertex shader, this is a fragment shader, and here I'm saying whatever position is input to me, just set that position. Forget all of this, we don't have time for it. But basically what I'm saying is, if you give me a position to draw, I will draw it, right? So our vertex shader is basically doing nothing, right? A fragment shader is saying that whichever pixel I draw, set its color to 1111, which is essentially white, right? White with full opacity. So 0 to 1 is the RGB level. Okay, so we have two very simple shaders. Vertex shader says whatever pixel value you give me, I will draw it. Fragment shader says, if you give me a pixel to color, I will color it white. Alright? The important thing about shaders is that they operate in parallel. And these are the instructions that are running in the GPU. Okay? So, if you have, let's say, 10,000 vertices in your drawing, let's say you are drawing that human body and it had 10,000 vertices, the vertex shader, all it's doing is setting the same vertex, right? But it will do it in parallel on hundreds of processors inside the GPU. Similarly, the fragment shader, when it's trying to color our Instagram image, if my image is 250 pixel by 250 pixel and it has to change the color of each pixel, it will do all of that in parallel. And in this case, this fragment shader will set all of them to white, right? So if you had a really nice image and you wanted to convert it into white, this is what you would do. Alright, so how do you run these programs, right? So these are two very simple GPU programs. One decides where to draw a pixel, the second decides how to color that pixel, right? So we've already got our context, everybody's seen it. If you've lost track, just tell me. What you do is you basically get that string. I've created my script as a DOM node, so you get that string. You tell the GPU to create a shader. So this is your CPU, this is a GPU. So here you say, you pass a message to the GPU to create a shader. So GPU allocates some memory for the shader. And figures out, okay, I have to create a shader. Then you say, the source of this shader is this string that I have in my CPU. Right? So when you do that, the string that we had stored in our script tag gets pushed to the GPU. Right? Once that happens, so this is what I did here, and then finally I compile the shader. So the GPU knows how to compile and understand that language. So when I say compile the shader, the GPU compiles it and throws an error if it has to, right? And remember, every time I'm doing context.something, I'm basically telling the GPU to do something. Almost 90% of time, some exceptions are there. Right, so this is how I do my work. Send my vertex shader to the GPU, right? Similarly, I will send my fragment shader to the GPU also. I have two programs, I send both of them to the GPU. Then I have to combine them. And this combined unit is called a GPU program or a shader program. And here I basically say create a program object, attach the vertex shader, attach the fragment shader, link the program and start using this program. Right? So simply I'm saying all that I gave you, start using it. Right? So we gave it two programs, remember. One was draw every pixel as it is given you. So the position of each pixel, don't modify it. Whatever is given to you, just draw it. And the second one basically sets the color of each pixel to white. Right? And this is where the pixel values are. So now I have to give it something to draw. Right? And in our case, we're going to draw a rectangle. Right? A very, very simple rectangle. Now, you might ask me that a rectangle, so this is my vertices of the rectangle. A rectangle has four vertices, but I've given it so many values, right? It's 12 and 12, 24 values. That doesn't make four vertices, that makes six vertices, right? So what's that, what's happening here? Six vertices, whatever, my math. So basically, the GPU draws triangles, right? So if you want a complex shape, if you have, let's say, a sphere, right? You could assemble the sphere with really, really small triangles. So the earth that we just saw in our example was essentially a set of thousands of triangles that look like 3 minutes. I will finish in 3 minutes. So the earth that we drew, and then we can stand outside and try to discuss it if you're interested. But basically, we'll have a sphere is basically a lot of triangles. Okay, so every drawing in the GPU is a bunch of triangles, right? And that is why my square that I'm trying to draw is also a set of two triangles. These two triangles being this triangle and this other triangle, right? And this is what I've input. So I've input the vertices are based on these two triangles. Now, what might be confusing you is the coordinate system. The coordinate system is very simple. This is 0, 0, and this corner is minus, minus, and this corner is plus, plus, right? So what I do is I've created this in a local array, right? Float32 is a special array which stores float values. Then you have to see, I said context.create buffer. So now I'm telling the GPU, create some space for these vertices, right? And then I bind the buffer, which basically says, take these vertices values which are in my CPU and put it into the GPU, right? Oops, sorry. And here I upload that data and I say that it is a static drawing. This is just some math that I have to set. This is important. So this line is basically saying that each of these vertex positions set it to this variable, right? And this is a variable that is existing in my vertex shader. So my vertex shader basically receives a variable of two values called vertex position, right? So these are the two coordinates and I need to pass them from the CPU to the GPU. And that is what I'm doing in this instruction. What I'm saying here is that everything that is there in my vertices array, push it to this variable, right? And then I'm doing basically the same line. I say clear color, which basically sets the default value which will be used when the context is cleared. And this clears the color, right? And this is where the drawing comes. So this is basically saying, do all of that stuff that you're supposed to do. So we'll just quickly run it. Okay, so get a square, right? Cool. I just too much paper stand and I will finish. We did that, and what I told it to do is draw triangles, but I can do something else as well. If I say line loop, I get to see the wireframe. So remember I told you that it's actually drawing triangles, but what you saw was, the square, but essentially it's drawing this triangle and this triangle, right? And that you can see here. So now, right? And this is how it essentially works. I will share all this in my GitHub and you can take a look. But let me add, right? This is the simple introduction to the fact that essentially you can run programs in a separate processor and these programs run parallel. The point being that when I gave it the vertex array, right, which had six vertices, it didn't draw the first vertex, then draw a line to the second vertex, draw a line to the third vertex. It did all of that in parallel, which means that it figured out the position. The vertex shader figured out that each vertex has to stay where it has to stay. The fragment shader in parallel figured out that each pixel has to be white. And this happened at one go rather than sequentially, which it happens in GPU. And this gives you a significant performance boost. But you don't actually have to call that draw ball. Right? You could do that computation and not call it at all, which is the main use case that I'm using it for, is to do data analysis. So GPU has dedicated hardware to do trigonometric operations, it has dedicated hardware to do matrix math. And because of that, if for example I wanted to multiply two matrices of 1024 into 1024 size, which is a really big matrix, right? And if I wanted to do multiplication, if I do it in the CPU, it takes me, I don't know, half a minute or so. If I do it in the GPU, it takes me a second. Right, if it's a fast enough GPU. And if you, for example, wanted to draw a complex data visualization, or you wanted to compute the probability of several things, GPU is a great place to do. But it works only if you have a collection of data. If you only want to operate on one data point, then GPU isn't really of value to you. It is valuable when you have parallel data to process. Right, and this was really brief and quick. I had a few more examples and stuff to show, but if you're more interested, we can do that outside. Thank you so much for coming. I hope it was very helpful.